Hosanna! Hosanna! Glory to your name, God. Glory to your name. Now, I know you don't have a prayer in your hand, but the prayer should be your heart. The prayer should be your wave offering. The prayer should be something that you need to give to the God. It could be your voice. Just say, Hosanna! 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 Glory to your name, God. We bless your name today, God. We thank you for what you did coming into Jerusalem, God. We thank you, Lord Jesus, for your love, your charisma, your character, everything that you brought, God. We saw it coming, God, and we thank you. That's why we give you honor. That's why we give you victory. That's why we proclaim your goodness. That's why, Lord, you are King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Hallelujah, Jesus. Glory to your name, God. Come on, even if you have to just shout Hosanna through this, Lord, just do it. Because this is the way you can proclaim him as your king. As he was coming in, they had branches all around.
Yeah.
They were waving.
Yeah.
They were showing their love and their joy and their appreciation of the king coming.
Yeah.
But the thing about it was that they knew that it was victory coming in.
Right.
It was the victory that they were celebrating. So it's something about when people with power that gets your attention. When they come in, when they make an entrance, it gets your attention.
Yeah.
When the judge enters into the courtroom, what we say, we all rise.
Yeah.
And everybody's eyes is on the judge.
Right. Right.
When the president comes into the room, what they say, everybody rise and everybody's eyes on the president.
Yeah.
Even at weddings, the bride,
right.
Everybody has to stand and they say, all rise.
Yeah.
Everybody's eyes is on the bride. Even at the reception, just as the bride and groom coming in, everybody, they say, all rise. Something about the main attraction when they coming into the room. It's something about when they're coming and you see them coming that you got to give them praise by clapping of the hands, by yelling thank you, we appreciate you, by even dancing, shouting, giving them all kind of glory, because it's something about, even when Carlos stood up when they gave him, what we all did, we gave him all his props because we acknowledged the main attraction. So when Jesus was coming in, they had the palm branches,
right?
Right.
Because they knew that he was the main attraction.
Right.
He knew that he was going to bring victory. He knew. They knew. But it was something before he came in that I want to read. When the large crowd, this is out of John chapter 12, verse 9 through 19. When the large crowd of the Jews learned that Jesus was there, they came not only on the account of him, but also to see Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. See, I heard of the miracles that took place. Now, I'm talking about today. I heard of the miracle. I know whom the miracles flow through, but I have to see it for myself to believe it. I got to be amongst the crowd. I know about Jesus, but where's this Lazarus, God? I know that he raised up. I heard about the miracles Pastor Chris performed up in here. I heard about it, but I'm not just going to just come to see Pastor Chris. I want to see the Jesus
that
spoke through him. But see, we get it missed. We get it convoluted sometimes because we think that it's about him. We thought it was about Lazarus, but it was about Jesus. They was coming to see Jesus. They was coming to see Lazarus because they wanted to see, because they knew what Jesus had done when he raised him from the dead. They wanted to see. The crowd was talking. People were speaking. They wanted to see, but they don't want to just see the miracles. They need to see the miracle worker.
Yeah. That's
good. They shouldn't have just wanted to see the created thing. They need to see the creator. So you have to understand that it's not about the works that we do. It's about the works in him. So when we come in and we giving him praise, we shouldn't just come and say, oh, I know that someone's going to get healed. I want to come see the healer.
That's it.
I want to be amongst the healers. So when I come, I'm a coming. I may not have a physical branch, but the branch is in my heart. So when I come, I'm going to praise him. I'm going to glorify him. Yeah, I'm amongst the large crowd, and I hear people talking. They running back talking to the Pharisees. They telling them about the Pharisees. They talking about him. Question. Are you coming for the one who bless? Are you coming for the one who is the blesser? Because if you're not coming for the evidence that you start to become more like the Pharisees, you just start to plot. Verse 10, so the chief priests made plans to put Lazarus to death as well. Because of an account of him, many of the Jews were going away and believing in Jesus. See, your testimony, your confession, your beliefs, your submission would draw people, not only to those who believe or has a desire to believe, but those who seem to seek, those who is seeking to destroy the assignment which you proclaim. Verse 12, this is the triumphant entry. The next day, the large crowd, see, this is that large crowd again. They had come to the feast, heard that Jesus was coming into Jerusalem. Hosanna!
Yeah.
Hosanna!
Yeah.
So they took branches and palm trees,
yeah,
and went out to meet him, crying, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, even in the King. See, we could come with our praise, but don't remember, you still got the crowd. You got people who still want to just see the blessing, but not the blesser. You still a part of the crowd. So when we came in here today, we know God is going to move. We know God is going to do something. But are you coming to see Jesus?
Right.
Are you just coming to see the miracle worker?
Right.
That he's going to perform. It was established already in our prayer. Let God, you let the Holy Spirit come and move in you. Yeah, you were called to speak. You were called to pray. You were called to do whatever assignment. But let the Holy Spirit, that means you allowing Jesus to come. And you're moving in him instead of moving in man. I don't want to be a part of the crowd. Yeah, even though the crowd is there, I want to see the miracle worker. Hosanna!
Hosanna!
I want to bless him.
Yeah.
I want to praise him.
Yeah.
I want to acknowledge him because he already proclaimed victory by coming in.
Yeah.
This is the understanding that we need to have. Yeah, we know about him. And what was great about this is that the disciples caught a revelation because, see, this was spoken in Zechariah. Zechariah 9, it said, and Jesus found a young donkey and sat on it, just as it is written, fear not, daughter of Zion. Behold, the king is coming, sitting on a donkey's colt. His disciples did not understand these things at first. But when Jesus was glorified, then they remembered that these things have been written about him, have been done. This was already prophesied in Zechariah 9, that he was going to ride in on a colt. There was going to be praises. There was going to be glorified. There was going to be submission. Don't be confused like the disciple. But then if you are, guess what? You're going to catch a revelation. Because you're going to understand that this was already proclaimed. So when we give God praise today, when we glorify him, remember what he did on Calvary. But it was his entrance that brought the attention. It was the main attraction. Let us praise him and glorify him. Amen.
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 Hallelujah. That's good. Good. That's good.
Let me hear you make some Holy Ghost crazy noise right now. Let me hear you.
No, you keep going.
Come on, God's people. Come on, buddy. Do more like this.
One of my favorite scriptures of how they recognized the king before he really took his seat on the throne. Okay, before he really took his seat on the throne next to the Father, that sometimes you feel like people don't recognize who you are, recognize the God in you, but there are those occasions when people can see it. We have our celebrities in the house, our celebrity members.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Send it back. You know, our filmmakers and author and comedian.
Yeah, that's right.
You know, our celebrity members. We had such a wonderful time on a fellowship last Sunday at the Improv as we celebrated our very own Carlos and Liz Fabian with a house without a father. And we were Wallace. As he also released his another book that we sure that's going to be a bestseller. We already speak it. Come on now, $1 million pen ink. Come on with it. Let's see. So I heard some of our members also went to an escape room.
Yeah.
Looks like y'all made it out.
Yeah.
Y'all made it out. Did y'all make it out on time?
Yeah.
Oh, you made it out on time. You made it out. Y'all had 10 minutes? Okay. Who emerged as the leader?
Everybody.
Yeah. Team effort.
Shout out to Jada for
Matt. Yeah. Yeah. It was the worship team and the media team. They did the escape room. They got out and they made it to church. Amen.
Yeah.
Amen. Amen. We have My Monsters coming up this Friday.
Yeah.
Come on, stop by our very own Pastor Tonette and Pastor Delicia.
Yeah.
Hopefully they know what they're talking about. Can we talk? My Monsters. Hopefully, right? Somebody pray for us. No. It's going to be a good time. Can we talk? And then I think I have one more. No. If you want the other announcements. Can we talk is Friday.
Oh, Friday.
Yes. Come on. Can we talk?
Saturday.
I don't even know the day. Saturday. Can we talk? It's Saturday.
Saturday.
And I think it's, I know what it is. Everybody get their Resurrection Sunday outfits together because next Sunday is Resurrection Sunday. Yeah. And we have Easter baskets. For the children, please go on iencounterchurch.com and register your child for an Easter basket. You can come pick them up on next week during our service hours. We're here at 10:30. Oh, wow. Look at my friend. Come on in. Come on in. No, but 22. Yes. Okay. Yes, we have a lot of baskets to give out. So if you know children, well over 30 baskets and counting, because people are still donating baskets. So please get your child registered and come join us next week as we give out a little joy to the little people that love the Lord. Amen. 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 So before I get down and let Pastor Chris come up, I had an assignment, y'all. I had an assignment on yesterday, and a part of the assignment was I was going into a room that wasn't mine. And I was going into this room to shift the atmosphere. That was my assignment, to change the trajectory of the room, to, you know, get the flow going in the room. And I began my assignment, and then I got locked out. Well, actually, I lost the key to the room. Okay? Did I tell you this wasn't my property? And I lost the key to the room, and for a moment I began to panic, and then I made a couple of phone calls, and then I was reminded that I know someone who has a master key.
Come on. Woo. Come on.
Come on, you already got it, right? I know someone who has a master key, so I was able to get into the room and complete my assignment. But here's the thing. After I left the room, the one with the master key locked the door. See, we think just because God opens a door and lets us in, that's where we're supposed to dwell. But sometimes it's just what it is, an assignment. You do what you're called to do, and then you come on and skate on out that room and wait to go to the next opportunity or the next door. But more importantly than that, even if you lost the key, even if you lost your way, you can always have the master key. You can always have the blacksmith, the master blacksmith, the master key that you can access any room at any time that he so chooses to put you in. Amen. Amen. And without further ado, if you'll please stand to your feet as we receive the man of God for this Palm Sunday. I'm so excited to hear a word. We've already got our Palm Sunday message, so I can't wait to hear what he has for us today. So please put your hands together for Pastor Corinne.
Amen. 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 Y'all be seated if you can. Be seated if you can. Amen. You got me, Bree? Amen. Yes, thank you, Pastor Lowe, for breaking down Palm Sunday for us.
Yep.
Amen. I wanted someone else to give their perspective on Palm Sunday. You know we love Palm Sunday. We always yelling out the Hosanna. We do it throughout the year, not just on Palm Sunday, but we do it throughout the year, the time that Jesus, as you said, was about to take his final ride and take his rightful seat at the right hand of the Father. And it's something about leading up to Resurrection Sunday that every year I always try to figure out, like, what was happening. I say this a lot. What was happening, like, right now? Like, if this was that year, what was happening around that time? If this was that year, what would be happening around that time? And so I wanted to paint that picture of the Palm Sunday for you. But also something that happened a little even more prior to that was where we're going to be at right now. We're going to be in the book of Matthew chapter 11. We're going to be in the book of Matthew chapter 11. Amen. I'm excited about this. This thought, it kind of merges with some of the stuff we've been teaching. It merges with some of the Bible studies. It merges with a lot of the conversations that we've been having here at Iron County Church. I'm confident that y'all are going to be able to get something from this. Matthew 11. Say, I got it, or hold on, bro. Somebody say, hold on, bro. Y'all know y'all. That's right. You got it? You there? You there? All right, y'all stayed up late last night, I can tell y'all stayed up late last night. Amen. Today I encounter faith.
Today I encounter faith.
Today I encounter hope.
Today I encounter hope.
Today I encounter love.
Today I encounter love.
I am a warehouse. For God to fill.
For
His purpose.
For His purpose.
In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Clap your hands up to the Lord right there. Now give him a clap for real. Give him a clap for real. Give him a clap for real. I'm going to give y'all what y'all give me today. I'm going to give y'all what y'all give me today. We're going to take our time today. Drag it on now. Restaurants will be good and empty by the time we get out of here. By the time I get this point across, you better get, you better go wherever you want to go to eat. You better go wherever you want to. Y'all already know this could be, this could be non-denominational church or it could be Baptist church today. Which one y'all want?
Non-denominational.
That means I need to hear you. It means wake up. That means wake up. Baptist church, y'all ain't woke till the first hour and a half is over. Do we need to call for another selection D? Not B, but D, a selection D. And a, another dunamis word. Maybe Dr. Iris got to feel like you got a word in your spirit just to warm us up. For the family. Y'all don't want to get warmed up. Y'all don't want another dunamis word. Y'all good? Y'all ready?
Yeah.
It sound like half of them. Yeah. Yeah. Let's get a word up in here, man. Let's get a word. Something I can use. Look at somebody say this for me. Yeah, okay. Let's play the game. We're gonna play the game. Stand up for a second. I'm gonna do something different. Stand up just for a second. Everybody stand up. Yeah, say hello to somebody. Yeah, let's wake up.
You don't know, bro.
Yeah. Take the time.
Sing the song.
Don't need no matches, we inspire.
I am.
Yes. Yes, we can talk all day, but if the anointing is not flowing,
come on now.
Who's going to get healed? Who's going to get helped? Y'all at Matthew 11, right?
There.
We're in Matthew 11. We already ready. Amen. Thank you, baby girl. Matthew 11. Matthew 11, starting at verse number 1. Now it came to pass when Jesus finished commanding his 12 disciples that he departed from there to teach and preach in their cities. And when John had heard in prison about the works of Christ, he sent two of his disciples and said to him, "Are you the coming one, or do we look for another?" Jesus answered and said to them, "Go and tell John the things which you hear and see. The blind see, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear, the dead are raised up, and the poor have the gospel preached to them. And blessed is he who is not offended because of me." Verse 7, as they departed, Jesus began to say to the multitude concerning John, "What did you go out into the wilderness to see? A reed shaking by the wind? But what did you go out to see? A man clothed in soft garments? Indeed, those who wear soft clothing are in the king's house. But what did you go out to see? Yes, I say to you, and more than a prophet, for this is he of whom it is written, 'Behold, I send my messenger before your face, who will prepare your way before you.'" Verse 11, "Assuredly, and I say to you, among those born of women, there has not risen one greater than John the Baptist, but he who is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. And from those days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffers violence."
Yeah.
There go our violent faith,
yeah,
y'all.
Yeah.
"And the violent taken by force, for all the prophets and the law prophesied until John. And if you are willing to receive it, he is Elijah who is to come. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. But to what shall I liken this generation? It is like the children sitting in the marketplaces and calling to their companions and saying," we almost finished, y'all. I know y'all don't really like to read this much, but like I said, I don't know who ain't read their Bible all week. We try to catch up. We played the flute for you and you didn't dance. We mourned to you and you did not lament. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they said he has a demon. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, "Look, a glutton and a wine bibber, a friend of the tax collectors and sinners." But wisdom is justified by her children. If we can teach from the thought today, a leap of faith, a leap of faith, a leap of faith. We have Jesus. He's not in the best of moods right now. He's pretty upset. If you read the whole chapter prior to and even after where we are right now, he's talking about the kingdom suffering violence and violence taken by force. And he's really upset because the cities are not taking hold of this gospel. There's a lot of doubters everywhere he looks. People are not hearing the word and grasping onto it. It sounds like 2024 is repeating what we're in Matthew chapter 11, because at that time it's just like this time where people don't want to hear nothing about the Bible. I'd rather hear something different. I'd rather hear, I go to this store, I get these crystals, I put them in my window, they charge, and the energy is right in my room. I'd rather hear that I'm God. I'd rather hear that I'm the original Jew. I'd rather hear anything but that I have to follow these regulations and have to repent. I'd rather follow anything other than thinking that I have to have someone as my Messiah, as a Savior, and that I have to be a servant. I'm tired of that. This is the first time in a long time, the kids, we talk about the kids on Bible study. Kids now, I don't know about y'all that's my age or a little older, a little younger. When we were young, if you heard somebody say they didn't believe in God, you almost passed out. Like, you didn't want to talk to them no more. You were scared of them. You were scared of that person say they didn't believe in God. Not necessarily not a Christian. You know, they can be Jehovah's Witness, they can be Muslim, they can be whatever, and didn't scare you, but for someone to say they don't believe in God or they don't know if God exists, that's where we are today. We're in a place where people don't believe in God. They're making up their own stuff. We call it eclectic, because they're grabbing a little bit of this religion and a little bit of that religion, and they're putting them all together, trying to make their own whatever it is that they want to believe, and they're loud. They're loud. They're louder than you. They're louder than the church.
Yeah.
They have the law behind them. They have the media behind them. They can say Christianity is not real, but if you say something is wrong with them being a non-believer, then you're a bully. They can say that you're wrong because you won't live the lifestyle that they live, but you can't say nothing about their lifestyle. You get counseled. You get counseled. You're living in a place right now where they're louder, they have the protection, and it's almost nothing that you're allowed to do about it. And here it is, you got John the Baptist. I don't know, let's talk about John the Baptist just to bring y'all up on speed. John the Baptist is Elizabeth's baby. Mary has Jesus, Elizabeth has John the Baptist. I don't know how much y'all know about this, but Mary goes and visits her cousin Elizabeth while she is pregnant. And when she approaches her older cousin, presumably John the Baptist is in her womb, Jesus is in Mary's womb. And when Mary comes in vicinity of Elizabeth, John the Baptist in the womb of his mother, the Bible says the Holy Spirit comes over him and he leaps in the womb. Many fascinating things about that. For one, we feel like the Holy Spirit didn't come until Jesus' death, burial, resurrection. He ascends and the Holy Spirit comes back. But here we see already the Holy Spirit was here with in John the Baptist. We know the Holy Spirit is how Mary got impregnated, the Immaculate Conception. Now here it is, John the Baptist, even in the womb, have experienced the Holy Spirit, and it being in the presence of Christ, he leaped. This is the forerunner. This is the one that the Bible talked about all through, from the beginning to the end, saying there's going to be one that's going to be, they call it a herald, the one that's going to broadcast the news that he's coming. He's coming. He's the broadcaster. That this is the one. That's the reason why when Jesus walked on the scene, he says, "Behold, the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world." Right. This is the one that actually got a chance to baptize Jesus.
Yeah.
I just want to paint a picture about who he is, just a little bit. Just a little bit of picture about John the Baptist. This is the one that when he was born, it was already said who he was going to be. They had been prophesying about him just as much as they had been prophesying about the Messiah coming. This is cousin. He recognized each other from the womb. This is the one that when Jesus come, he recognized. This is the one that when Jesus told him to baptize him, he was like, I will not. You baptize me. This is the one that baptized Jesus. And when Jesus came out of the water, he saw the Holy Spirit come down and ascend on Jesus like a dove. This is the one that was baptizing people unto his ministry even before Jesus came, saying, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand," and Jesus comes. And this is the one that was out in the wilderness, away from everybody else, guarding his ear gate and his eye gate and his heart, and making sure that he was prepared for what he had to do. And so he was out in the wilderness, and he was like, I'm not going to eat no good food. I'm not going to drink no good wine. I don't party. I'm eating locusts and drinking honey. Like, I'm out. This is all. I'm full of focus. This is all I'm doing right now. And he does it so to a point that people are leaving the city and the towns and the luxury to go out to the wilderness. You got to understand, the wilderness is not just the street is here and trees are there, and you step 10 feet into the trees and you're in the wilderness. No, the wilderness is out there.
Yeah.
You gotta travel. You gotta go through some stuff to get to the wilderness. The wilderness is already the wilderness, but there's some stuff that you gotta go through just to get to the wilderness. The wilderness ain't right there. Just because you had a good day yesterday, you're having a bad day today, don't tell me you're in the wilderness. That's not the wilderness. The wilderness is you've been going through some stuff and going through some stuff, and you keep going deeper and deeper, and you end up in the wilderness. This is John the Baptist. I mean, God had to talk to this man since birth. And this is the same man that he had told the king Herod that he was wrong. I don't know if you understand some people's power. I don't know where y'all work at. If you allow to chastise your boss or your supervisor, I don't know if y'all know where you work. If that works like that for you, you know, if you just tell them, hey, that ain't cool. Cut that out. Stop that. I don't know if you're allowed to talk to your supervisor like that. You know, I don't know. Some of y'all in relationships, you can't even talk to your partner like that. But that's a whole other thing. King Herod has went to go visit his brother. And he sees his brother's wife.
Yeah.
They just say, girl must be mad. Because he talks to her into coming back with him and takes his brother's wife.
What is called?
And then he gets home and divorces his wife.
Oh, wow.
And marries his sister-in-law.
Oh.
The boy dirty. And so the boy dirty. John the Baptist tell him, bro. I'm just trying to make y'all see the picture. I need y'all to understand. That ain't cool. And Herod is mad for being called out. Herod is mad for being called out. And so he put John the Baptist in jail. And John the Baptist is in jail again. And he's about to die this time, though. They're about to kill him. They're about to behead him. And so now he's in jail. But still, even though he's going through what he's going through, doesn't he know for sure who Jesus is? I mean, I'm just this with I'm just bear with me. Let's just you know, I figured I'd come here and I just read the scripture and y'all can give me the answer. I just figured I'd just read this verse number 2. And when John had heard in his prison about the works of Christ, he sent 2 of his disciples. Because y'all know when he was baptizing the disciples unto him, John the Baptist, and said to him, are you the coming one, or do we look for another? John the Baptist about to die. He's in jail. His whole life has been saying the Messiah is coming. Everything he has done has been about Jesus. And now, at the end of his life, I'm saying, now he's questioning.
Yes.
Are you the one?
Yes.
Yes. Now he's finally questioning. It just seems odd that he would question, are you the one? But I'm the question that God told me to ask you is, have you had a John the Baptist moment?
Come on.
Where things are going a little funny style.
Yes.
And you ask, look, I'm not asking. No, I don't need y'all to understand what I'm asking. That ain't what today is about. Hey, Resurrection Sunday next week, we need to make sure you really get it. I'm not asking you, did you question God was going to do something for you?
Right.
I'm not asking that. I'm not asking about that kind of doubt. Yeah. That you asked him for something and you felt like he was going to do it and he showed you the vision of it and everything a little shaky right now and you doubt if he's going to do it and if you're going to pull it out. I ain't talking about that. I know the answer to that. Yes.
Yeah,
that moment. I gotta ask you that, okay? I'm asking you, have you had the moment? Don't say it out loud.
Okay.
But it's those that say no, people are looking crazy, and those that say yes, I ain't gonna do it. Have you had the moment that you said, is Christ the way? You know what I'm saying? Has it ever got so bad?
that you thought about them Christians. That you thought about that. Maybe Jesus and the Savior.
Yeah.
Maybe I read both the Quran and the Bible. Look at it. Jesus, my boy, look at that, like double portion, like wow. Extra strength. I'm just want to know, has something happened? Have you had a John the Baptist moment where you actually question Christ? Or is there a God? Because it's happening. It's happening.
This is not the talk that we normally have to have in church.
But that's what's happening right now, 2024. That's what's happening right now, is people are falling away from God. Do you understand that, like, we talk about statistics of people even returning back to church after the pandemic? It's not happening. People not coming back to church. People would rather stay home and watch from their couch, watch from their, and we already know most people, they tune in and they make three comments and tune out. Just make it seem like they was on there. I mean, we know how it go. But I'm just saying, I want y'all to be careful of falling out of relationship with God to the point where you start questioning, is he real? Is Christ the way? And after all that John the Baptist has been through, fall into that. Can't you fall into that? Can't you fall into questioning? Can't you lose your lead? You ever lost your leap? We're talking about a leap of faith. We're talking about a leap of faith because he's not gonna show your faith into substance things, hope for evidence, things not yet seen. And so he's not gonna just show you everything. He wants to know that you believe and you just believe. Because he is, and he's a rewarder of those that diligently seek him. And you're supposed to have this cachet. You're supposed to have this cachet of evidence. Even though they say he don't give you evidence, it should be some history. Right. It should be some resume. Yeah. And that's evidence to me. That's what I'm saying. I mean, I said the other day, we were all talking, I said my faith is my proof. Which is kind of, it's like an oxymoron. Faith is no evidence. But I'm saying faith is my proof. Because I've had faith and it's happened, and that's evidence for me. So now I have evidence.
Yeah.
So how come we're losing our leap? Like even today when we can't, like even today, I don't know, did we not get enough rest? Did we forget to get excited about God? Because I know when Pastor Lowe got up here, he was full of energy. I know when Minister Linwood and the worship got up, I saw them. They were ready. They were, Minister Linwood was jumping. Yeah. Man, the brother was jumping. I'm like, I'm 52. I ain't jumped in a while. Some of us can't leap like that. But he was literally leaping. But there's a different kind of leap in your spirit that you should still have. Are you getting tired of worshiping God? Are you getting tired of acknowledging him? Do you understand that it's very few things that can get you out of the place that you're in when you lose your leap, when you get to questioning things, because you start questioning things when things not going right, when you're in prison. When you're in prison and it feels like death and you feel like you're not going to come back from this thing that you're going through, and it feels like you're not coming, you feel like John the Baptist, and you feel like you're about to finish your race, and you're wondering, have I been doing it right? Is there anything I need to alter? Is there any last minute audible I can call at this moment and change things up? And it comes down to like what David said when he said he encouraged himself. He said, give me my priestly robe. You wanted his praise gone. The only way he was able to encourage himself was to go into worship, was to go into praise, was to go into his presence. That's the only way. That was the only way that he was able to go into worship.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
The only way he was able to get his leap back. To get his leap back, and it said that Jesus told
Jesus told him, go and tell him what you see here. The blind see, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised up, the poor have the gospel preached to them. So Jesus, for one, a lot of people are asking, I'm speaking about theologians, I ask him, did John really doubt? Or was he just sending his disciples to Jesus where they could form a connection with Jesus? I asked Pastor Delisa, I said, what do you think? She said, well, it's about how Jesus answered. But Jesus knows, right? So if Jesus knows this is just a setup for a relationship, he would answer like this and say, go tell John all you see. He told him, go tell John all you see. In other words, he sent them back to encourage John. In other words, John really was doubting. He really was doubting. John. John, man. Like Peter denying Christ after all he saw.
Yeah.
It's like Moses being disobedient after the parting of the. You don't think you do that? You don't think you do that? You don't think that the evidence that God has given you in your life should be enough for you to remember that he is God. And look, let me tell you something. I really don't doubt y'all. I don't really don't doubt y'all. I know that seems like where I'm going with this. What I'm going with this is, where's the part where when they come in your space, not just on Sunday, not just here on Thursday for their gift, but out there, where's the part where you give them something to go report. I'm just saying, turn it up a notch. And you won't be able to turn it up a notch unless you turn up your worship a notch. Your seeking God a notch. If you turn that up a notch, you'll know what to do to support the church in order to make it where when you go out and you're living your daily life, non-financial stuff, just the way you move out there, and people have some kind of report. So when somebody say, I heard that she a Christian, and you're like, well, how she act? She got an attitude. She funny style. She married, but she be on the phone with some man on lunchtime. No, I hope y'all catch this because this is your sermon. That's it.
Hosanna.
This is it. This is the part I want you to get. This is what God was saying. God is saying, what are you doing that someone can use you to go report back to those people that's questioning if he won? I'm not just talking about I encounter, but what are we doing? I encounter included, but really the body of Christ. What are we doing to make the brothers that want to be Hebrew Israelites feel like,
yeah.
I see it now. I was dumbfounded for a while, but I see it now. I see it now. We were here yesterday. We had somebody use the sanctuary for something, and I had three different brothers at three different times come to say, hey. And I had 10-minute conversation with each one of them. The first one was like, oh, you doing Sabbath, brother? He had a beard. I knew he was like, I said, no. I said, we do understand that the original Sabbath day was on Saturday, but we don't do what the law says. We do what Jesus and the apostles did. And I said, and we know that Pentecost was on a Sunday, and that was the day that they gathered together because the Bible said, and seven Sabbath days had passed, Saturday being Saturday. Seven days had passed, 49 days was seven Saturday. And it said, and on the next day, they met up in the upper room. So if that was 49, on the next day, make it 50. That's why they call it Pentecost, but Pentecost is the Greek word for 50, right? So Pent is Greek word for five, like Pentagon. Pentecost is Greek word for 50, so it's 50 days later. So it wasn't on Sabbath that they met
and tongues came down on everybody, and the Holy Spirit came down on everybody. It wasn't on Saturday, it was on Sunday. But that's why we do Sunday. So we don't argue about was the original Sabbath day on Saturday. We don't do that because we know it was, but not anymore. Is the Sabbath day Sunday now, really? Really not. It's the day we meet up because Jesus is the Sabbath. He said, one man esteem one day above another, another man esteem every day the same. But Jesus said, I am the Sabbath. See, God want to give you a different kind of rest. You think God's rest want to give you, God want to give you a one-day rest from pain, from stress, from struggle? You think he's saying, it's one day a week you're not going to shed a tear. It's one day a week. It's going to be one day a week you ain't going to cry here. I got on with no, yeah, I'm going to let you rest that day from that pain. You think one day, you, Wednesday. You want to do it Wednesday? Do it Wednesday. You want to do it Saturday? Cool, do Saturday. You want Sunday? You got Saturday, Sunday. What day you want to do it? And that's why he talks about my rest. He doesn't say a rest. He said, you shall not have my rest. He's talking about my rest. His rest is in him and is every day. In Christ is every day. It's an everyday kind of rest. So he sends them off telling them, go tell him what it is that you see. And then he goes on. I don't know if y'all missed it. Y'all been missing it, but Minister Linwood has been giving us a Bible study on the Beatitudes in Matthew chapter 5. And here we are in Matthew chapter 11. And it just seems like God went ahead and told Jesus, add another Beatitude. add another one. I know we talked about it in Matthew 5 and 6. And Matthew 5 and 6 was, blessed is he who hungers and thirsts for righteousness, for he shall be filled. And best are they who mourn, they should be. And best are the peacekeepers. And that's what we're going to pick up at on Thursday. Blessed are the peacekeepers. But right here, chapters later, Jesus said, let me add another one. Let me add another one. And he says, blessed is he who is not offended because of me. Blessed is he who is not offended because of me is what he says. And we have to go look that up in the Greek, and the word is scandaliso in Greek, literally, is where we get the word scandalize from the Greek word scandaliso, which means offended. It means to entrap, to stumble, to entice to sin, apostasy, displeasure, to make offend. Blessed is he who is not offended by me. What is he saying? He's saying, blessed is he who can still be in jail, even though I'm his savior, and still believe in me. Blesses her that can be wondering where this husband is. I've been telling her he's going to show up, and he hasn't shown up, and she still hasn't cut me off because she's not offended by the fact I haven't moved yet. She's not offended by the way I'm moving. Because I know y'all think I'm supposed to be moving a certain way.
Yeah.
John the Baptist is saying, hey, I've been saying you the same. Savior. I'm locked up. You're going to kill me. Let me out of here. I don't know if y'all ever been locked up before. Well, boy, that's a well-known prayer. Get me up out of here. I was in there 3 days and told the Lord, I'm rehabilitating. You let me out. I'm rehabilitating. Look, I'll never do it again. I literally said I'm rehabilitating. Got out penitentiary and opened up after hours. So I'm being honest. He didn't let me out when I prayed that prayer, because he already knew. Boy, you ain't done yet. He already knew. Blessed is he that is not offended by me, because I don't show up like you think I should show up. But we back to the fact that they've been waiting on the Messiah to come, and they thought that when he came, he was going to get rid of the Romans out of Jerusalem and kick them out, and they were going to go right back to, you know, how it used to be.
Elite.
Christ is saying, can I just do me? I could see everything. That's not Pastor Chris talking. That's what Christ is saying.
I can see everything. And I don't have you moving right now, because if you move right now, you're not going to either be able to sustain it, manage it, handle it. You're not in a position to understand what you, to have all the wisdom you need to have about it right now. I need you to understand I know what I'm doing.
Come on.
Yeah, yeah. Thank you, Lord.
So even with John the Baptist, he was saying, you blessed is he that's not offended by me, that I'm not moving like you want me to. Because, and then he gets really upset, and he said, because guess what? I don't care what I do, you still ain't happy. No, that's what he just said. Y'all missed it? What he said that? I read it. I'm sure I read it. He said, let me find where he said it at, so y'all won't think I'm crazy. He says, let's find it right here. Ah, there you go. Verse number 18 is what Jesus said. It don't matter what I do, y'all still ain't happy. But John came neither eating nor drinking, and they said he had a demon. I came eating and drinking. You like, this boy gluttony, hang out with the tax collectors. If I come eating and drinking, I'm wrong. If I don't eat and drink, I'm wrong. He's like, it don't even matter how I come. Then he goes on to say, y'all like the kids. Y'all, if I play music, you don't dance. It don't matter what I do. No matter what I do, y'all still gonna want the other. Y'all gonna want to do it a whole different. Y'all gonna want to do it a whole different way than the way that I'm trying. Trying to tell you. I'm telling you to get back to your leap. Get back to your leap. The thing. Don't you remember when you first got saved? Anybody remember that? That New Zeal.
Yeah.
That New Zeal. You telling everybody? I'm getting baptized. Yeah. Get baptized. Y'all remember that?
Yeah.
You remember that? That New Zeal. That's what you need. You need to get back to that. And we got to get back to doing some things to make it effective where people can see you.
Yes.
And they can go and tell somebody that he is real.
Yeah.
What does the leap look like? Are y'all scared to worship in front of somebody? Y'all pray over y'all meal when y'all with y'all co-workers?
Yeah.
Or do you say a silent prayer?
Great.
You just be like, yeah, girl, because I was saying. We should be like, it's people that care, they see him, like to say right here. They want you to see it and dare you to say something. Dare you to say something. They say, even when you go down, like I say, that's our scripture for the year, violent faith, since the time of John the Baptist till now, the kingdom of heaven suffers violence as a violent taken by force. We got to be just as forceful as them. They're trying to come in and take the gospel away from you. They're trying to come in and take the gospel. You gotta be willing to fight back. You got to be willing to say, and I'm not saying fight back, argue. Just be the light. Just be the light. I'm going to tell you, some of us are not doing anything to be examples. We're not doing nothing. I know you're tired. I get it. I appreciate it. Church appreciate it. We do. But what about the thing that draws people back? Can you be a magnet to draw people back to church? Why is it nobody is asking you where you go to church?
Yeah.
Why nobody following you to where you worship? Are you separating the two worlds? Are you giving one attitude over here and another attitude over there? Are you treating people one way over here and another way over here? Get back to the leap. Get back to the leap. Get back to the excitement of Christ. It's next week is Resurrection Sunday. There was a power that God gave to raise him from the dead, a power. And he said, you have that same power.
Yeah.
Just that alone should make your spirit leap, to know that it's the same power that raised him from the dead.
Yeah.
If that power can raise him from the dead, what can that power do for you?
He says the same power. The same power. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Stand to your feet. Amen. Hey, did you pass it? Tony? Gotcha.
Amen. 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 Finish your worship, JJ. Finish your worship. Now, JJ, I love JJ. JJ got this cue. Anytime he sees me get a mic,
yeah,
he just come run up here. He think I'm about to do a worship song.
Yeah.
He might do one after. No, I love it. I love it. This is amazing work. Give God, give the word a hand clap of praise. Give the word another hand clap of praise. Leap of faith. Leap of faith. It's amazing what that word is. Because it was, I was able to see that leap of faith again personally. So I want to say this past week on Wednesday, I went with, a lot of us know Pastor Courtney, Pastor Ashley. Pastor Courtney was preaching a sermon at Prairie View for the FCA. And so I was up there, you know, I'm doing my videoing and all that type of stuff. And he gives a word, amazing word. And it's a lot of young, of course, you know, college kids. I think they were basketball teams, soccer teams, football players in there, things of that nature. He did an amazing word, but they were able to watch and see that zeal, see that movement, see us working as a unity. That after it was done, she was so excited with joy. She ran up and was like, "Do you preach at a church? What do you? I don't have a church. What do y'all like?" She was so inquisitive of how is it that y'all could move like this. We haven't had an opportunity to see something like that. So that's a great example of us being able to go out and continuing to be what God has called us to be so that we can show them the works. So we can show them what they wasn't concerned about the person. They wanted to see who is this God that you serve that has you speaking and moving and walking like that. So the leap of faith that this person had was such astonishing. And so that's such an amazing thing. So as we begin, if I can get Dunamis up here, please. There's something that's weighing on your heart. There's something, if something is weighing on your heart, if there's something that you started to take that leap and right before you got to the edge to jump across, you stopped. Whatever that is that's going on with you right now, this is an amazing time to come up. We have powerful prayer warriors here that are willing to come into agreement to help you be able to take that step back, gain that momentum, and finally take that leap of faith. Take that leap of faith into what it is that God is calling you to do. He's asking you to sacrifice. He's asking you to move away from. He's asking you to move into. Don't continue to walk up to the line and stop, because what happens is when you gain that momentum because you're excited but you're afraid of how far the jump could be, you'll stop so hard you'll hurt yourself. You can pull something, you can tear something, and now you created more damage to yourself than just taking the leap of faith. Well, on the other side was your healing. On the other side was your deliverance. On the other side was your wholeness. On the other side was the job. On the other side was the financial breakthrough. On the other side was the family coming together. On the other side was just anything that you had ever asked for. On the other side is you being able to have a book that's best-selling, to be able to go amongst and make movies, to be able to have people walking through here in droves to come in and want to know who it is that God is. Who is it? What is your drive? What is it? What is it that you're going to lead to? What are you going to not stop and do? Will you take the lead? You can come up right now. You can come up right now. Whatever it is that's holding you back. Whatever it is right now that's holding you back. Something as simple as a microphone messing up will not stop. Whatever it is that God is asking me to do. To speak to those that is still stopping right before the leap. We've leaped to so many things in our past that have led to our destruction. It led to our breakdown. Let's leap to healing. Let's leap to restoration. Please come up. And if you don't want to come up, but you just want to put your hand there, anybody that's online, type it in. Don't be afraid. Don't be ashamed. Because if something was moving inside of you right now, be obedient to what the Spirit is telling you. Everybody has to take a leap. There's not one person walking this earth that will not have to take the leap or have not taken a leap. The question is, what are you leaping for? You can put trust in our Father. The one that when he was taking his final ride through, they shouted Hosanna. Someone that knew his time was coming on this earth to an end. But he was willing to take a leap. He had no fear. He was ready to fulfill. Be ready to fulfill what it is that you need. Please come up for prayer. Type it in. We want to come into agreement with you. We're ready because we understand, because we've either been there, we're there currently, or we know we will be there again one day. Be so ready that when you take a leap, it's just normal to you. You well trained for it. It's nothing to you to go take this leap. When you land, you're not hurt. When you land, you're not exhausted. When you land, you feel free. Be able to take whatever leap it is that God is asking you to take. Make it part of your regimen. Make it easy. Thank you so much. Doing this, you can have a seat, please. Thank you. For anybody, yes, we got a hand clap of praise. Give them that. For anybody who was trying to discover who Christ is, if you haven't, if you want to discover the person that when we take the leap, we have no fear. That we trust that when we leap into him. If you want to get to know who that person is, please type it in online. But we want to celebrate and rejoice with you with that. We want to be on that other end. So when you make that leap, we can embrace you. We can hug you. We can give you motivation to take that leap. Does anybody here, please, step forward, raise your hand, whatever it is, God is speaking to you for. Everybody in here, they know Jesus, right? Everybody know Christ. All right, amen. That means we're going. All right. To the last part, y'all know the part. If there's anybody who is looking for a church home, the best church on what?
This side of heaven.
No, we're going to do that again. The church that's what?
On this side of heaven.
Best what?
This side of heaven.
Okay, there we go. The best church on this side of heaven. A church where we're going to get taught the word, the true meaning of the word. I know y'all hear our pastor be up here talking about Greek and the Hebrew. He can pronounce it. And I ain't there yet. I'm still trying to figure out this English language. And he won't be there. What's the pastor? Minister, did you? Pastor, listen. you know how you pray underneath your breath? When you get some hard words, you kind of rumble underneath them. I'm still getting there. But if you would love to join I Encounter, where it's many different ministries, it's many different things that we're partaking in, to where we're all moving toward unifying the kingdom and bringing those to Christ, a place where you can come and get to learn even more in detail with loving pastors, assistant pastors, ministers, and just members of the church that are willing to embrace you. There's no hug like a pastor told that hug when you walk through the door. There's no hug like that because it's filled with love. Love, not judgmental. We want to embrace you because everybody has a history. We can't wait to turn it into a testimony. So if you have that, if you have a church home, if you're looking for a church home, please type it in. Please type it in. All right, that was amazing. Once again, let's give the word of God a hand clap of praise. Let's give the man of God a hand clap of praise. We thank you so much for that, Pastor. That's amazing. Thank God. This is going on to the next part. Uh-oh.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
There it is. Thank you, Lord. Great word today. Great word. Show me something totally different when I saw this. And it correlates with this time we are right now, with our tithes and with our offerings. Stepping out on faith. We can do it voluntary or involuntary. Our leap of faith. God has called each and every one of us to give. That is his purpose in our heart to give, not grudgingly or necessity, for God loves a cheerful gift. Very quickly, Pastor, if you'll allow me, I want to share my testimony again. When I came into the church the first time, and it was time to give, when the offering plate came around, and I was reasoning within myself, man, $600, man. That was a lot of money back then, y'all. $600. $60 was tithe. $60. And I looked at it. And faith was different to me. Because we know faith is voluntarily and involuntarily. You can take that jump voluntarily, or you can be forced to take that jump, which is the difference. When the children of Israel was being followed by Pharaoh in their armies, they were forced to take that jump. That's the difference when you have nowhere else to go. But you can do it on your own. Don't wait for favorable conditions to make that jump. And I looked at that and said, man. That's a lot of money.
Teach us.
What does God need my money for? You ever find yourself questioning, what does God need this for? Why do you need my money? Well, the first thing is, it's not your money. And the second thing is, not for God's, for your blessing. Mm-hmm. It's for you. Sometimes we have to give of ourselves because it's for us, and we don't see that. Sometimes we see that we give them from ourselves, but we got to get something back. If you're looking today and you want to be a blessing, don't wait for it to be by force. Don't wait for a favorable condition, because guess what? Favorable conditions very rarely come. Favorable conditions, think about the lottery. Everybody's playing right now, but everybody's not going to win. It's going to be one or two people maybe, probably won't even be here. Don't wait for the favorable conditions. You make your favorable conditions. Make your favorable conditions. Now, we have four ways to give. It's not up to cash. That's at the very top. We don't see it on the screen. The cash is king. We have Zelle, Cash App, and PayPal. Be a blessing by choice today. And also want to remind you that our pastors, if you want to be a blessing to our pastors, in the top of the, it has love offering on the envelope of your sending in online, make sure you specify love offering so we'll know that it's for the pastors. Believe me, our pastors are not too proud to accept a donation. You want to bless them with $1,000, $10,000, I'm sure there will be no rebuffs at all. None. Be a blessing today. Be a blessing today. Don't wait for everything to be taken care of first. If God is speaking to you right now, do it right now. Don't wait till tomorrow, what God has called you to do today. Be a blessing to our encounter. Amen? Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. I sweat it with that. If you hold your envelopes up, you want to pray over them first. If anyone else needs an envelope, you can raise your hand and we'll get you an envelope. Thank you, Father. Make that leap of faith. Let it be by our choice, Father. We thank you, Father, right now in Jesus' name. Thank you for this time of giving, Lord. We thank you for any blessings, Lord, that is coming to our encounter right now, Father. We thank you for the people that are being a blessing, Lord. We thank you for the obedience of the people. We thank you, Father, that each and every person that is giving cheerfully, Lord, not grudgingly, not of necessity, Lord, not because they want something, but giving to be a blessing unto our encounter, Father. We thank you for the blessings that are coming in even now for our pastors, Lord, for Pastor Chris and for Pastor Delisha. We ask that you multiply back to each and every person today, Father. Each and every person within the sound of my voice. And those who don't have anything to give, Lord, but desire to give, Father. Let them be a blessing as well, Lord, as they may be able to give the next time. We thank you for reminding us of your word, your promises, Lord. Thank you for reminding each and every person, Lord, that a seed in our hand will never grow, Father, but that it has to be sowed, Lord, for us to reap a harvest, a plentiful, a bountiful harvest, Father. We thank you for allowing us this time to give, Lord, and not just give, but to give freely, Father. Give freely, Lord. Let us all take that leap of faith, Father, and not wait for favorable conditions. We thank you for this time of giving, Lord, and we give you the glory and the honor and the praise. We thank you, Father, and we love you in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. 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 Praise the Lord. Please bring your offerings and your tithes up, love offerings. Thank you, Jesus.
Glory be to God. Pastor Saul has dated himself. When do we pass the offering plate around? I mean, is it still a plate? Glory be to God. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Didn't we have a wonderful word today? How many of you are spectators? How many were spectators? How many were spectators? I know nobody don't want to raise their hand. But the fruit is going to show if you were a participator today. Amen. Amen. It's going to show because we're going to hear some testimonies about some folk that took some leaps. Amen. Right. And maybe you've been grounded for a little while. Hallelujah. You've been grounded for a little while. And God is saying, okay, I've released the word to you. Now I need you to go ahead and write that book. Amen. Amen. I need you to go ahead and start that business. All right. Hallelujah. Don't point at me. Glory be to God. I'm going to need you to go ahead and sing that song. I'm going to need you to go ahead and preach that word. You know, God is saying, I released the word to you. Amen. And so today we came to sit silently and not move. That means that you're only a spectator. And so you're asking God and you're in your prayer closet saying, Lord, please open doors for me. Please connect people with me. Please do these things for me. You said, but you weren't doing nothing but sitting there spectating. I gave you the word. I told you what to do. And he says, but now I'm looking for some participators. Because the kingdom of God got some work. God got some work for you to do. And the kingdom of heaven needs you. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. So I'm excited about that word. I praise God. I want to just give a quick testimony. Quick. A couple of weeks ago. I've been exercising, y'all.
Come on.
Don't clap like that. Okay. Now. Hallelujah. Okay. You exercise. Okay. Amen. Hallelujah. Oh, get excited. Anyway, I was exercising last week. I was exercising a couple of weeks ago, and all of a sudden, I couldn't breathe. Amen. I was just in the hospital a couple of days ago, before then, and I couldn't come to church and all that kind of stuff. And so that day, I was walking, and I was running, and I couldn't breathe. I had to stop. I had to slow down. And God said, you got a blood clot. He said, I had a blood clot in my lungs. He did. Y'all don't have to look at me like that because I'm praising God about to run. And so that day when I got home, I started bleeding in my mouth. I started bleeding. Amen. Praise God. Look at y'all looking sad. Come on now. Hallelujah. And so I just kind of rested that day, and I was just kind of a little lethargic, and I just rested and I prayed, and we had just went to the conference that Sunday and said, be healed. We went to the Be Healed conference. And so I laid my hands on myself and I said, be healed. Praise God. I said, I ain't going back to no more hospitals. Amen. I'm doing the work now. I'm doing the work.
Right.
And so that morning I woke up, I had a mouthful of blood. I had a mouthful of blood that morning, Pastor, Minister. And in that, it was a mouthful of blood and a blood clot. And a blood clot was in my mouth. When I spit it out, it was a blood clot and it was full of blood. So I went to the hospital. But on the way to the hospital, God said, you healed already. What you going to the hospital for? Amen. He said, you healed already. What's going on with you? Why are you going to the hospital? But he said, I need you to go to the hospital so that can show you right. what I did.
Right.
Yeah.
And so when I got to the hospital, I was feeling bad. I was feeling lethargic. And so they were like, they did 1,000 tests on me. But guess what? It wasn't one blood clot in my lungs. Hallelujah. Glory be to God. And so I went to the track. I promise you, Carlos, I went to the track the next day. See, some of y'all would have been still sitting there in the bed and crying, and I went the next day because I wanted to show the enemy that I'm healed. So I went to the track the next day, and I ran the entire track.
Boy,
I didn't walk the track. I ran the entire track. Without huffing, without puffing. Hallelujah. I did the whole track. I did 3.2 miles. Running. Y'all better run with me. Hallelujah. Y'all better run with me. And I've been running ever since. I haven't stopped. I'm doing 4 days a week.
Come on.
Glory be to God. Because I'm getting ready for a marathon.
That's right.
Yeah. Hallelujah. And I'm serious about it. Glory be to God. And so I just wanted to encourage y'all, leap of faith is real.
Yeah.
It's real. Because I woke up that morning with a mouthful of blood. That clot was supposed to kill me.
Yeah.
It was headed to kill me.
Yeah.
But God let it pass through my mouth.
Yeah.
Y'all better move.
Yeah.
There is power. There is life. There is death and life in the power of your tongue. And God will cause things to come out of your mouth. He will cause your healing
come
to
on.
Come through your come mouth.
On.
Hallelujah. Glory be to God. I'm running, y'all.
Yeah.
4 days a week.
4 days.
Four. Four. I'm going 4 days a week. I'm getting ready to add another day. I'm getting ready to add another day. And Minister Lynn would want to throw some stuff at me, but
I have to.
Hallelujah. But glory be to God. I'm getting ready to add another day and lifting my track. Pastor Lisa been teaching me some things about the marathon. If y'all got some things to help me with the marathon, come on, glory be to God. And I'm going, you coming too small? Okay. Yeah. Hallelujah. So I just wanted to testify that leap of faith is real.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I done sat for many years and leap of faith is real. My office is almost completely redone.
Yeah.
God is doing so many things because of a leap of faith.
Yeah.
And I'm telling you, I'm a testimony, and Carlos and Liz are testimonies. And if you just need some testimonies around you, look at your people that's around you.
Yeah, right.
If you think you can't do it, you can do it.
Yeah.
Because guess what? When I win the medals, I'm bringing them all to church.
Come on,
right.
Come on.
I'm bringing them all to church.
Come
and
on.
I'm going to have them on me, and I'm going to say, look what the Lord has done. Because I shouldn't even made it around that track. I made it home that day, but when I got home, my mouth started bleeding. And the next day, I had a mouthful of blood, but it was passing through. So y'all better get excited with me. Hallelujah. Y'all better get excited with me. I'm excited. I'm here today because God, only by his grace.
Right.
Only by his grace. So I'm just giving God praise this morning. I just wanted to share it with y'all. Hallelujah. I just wanted to share with y'all. I don't want y'all to be sad. Hallelujah. What would be sad if I was dead? What would be sad if I was in the hospital and I couldn't walk no more? That would be sad. Then I have to have y'all all come to my house and pray for me. Because it was a time I couldn't walk. It was a time that I was walking with a walker. It was a time when rheumatoid arthritis said that you never gonna walk again. I am a walking testimony, y'all.
Yeah.
I am a running testimony.
Yeah.
So glory.
Yeah.
Glory.
Yeah.
And if I could, I'd let you put the music on and we just dance for a few minutes because God is that good.
Yeah.
I'm just telling my friends. Hallelujah. What, Jay? Say it to me. Okay. All right. Let us pray. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's stand and pray. Let's give Pastor another hand clap for the word that God sent us today. I'm expecting to hear about businesses and I'm expecting to write some books. I'm going to write some books. I'm going to write a book. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Father, before I pray, I need everybody to invite somebody next Sunday. I need everybody to invite somebody. If they children need an Easter basket, that'll be the reason to invite them to church next Sunday. Hey, we're going to give you a basket if you come to church. Amen. You got to bribe people sometimes. You got to bribe them. Hallelujah. I mean, what? After Jesus had fed the 5,000 or the 7,000, and after he fed them the next day, everybody started following him. He said, you only follow me because you want the bread. Well, hey.
You want some bread? Come on.
Hallelujah. Glory be to God. Wherever we get you in the seat, come on in here. Hallelujah. So, Father God, we just bless you today because that word was amazing. Magnificent God. Thank you, Lord God, for giving us the strength and the energy, Lord God, to take that leap of faith. Lord, may we get it out of our heads and begin to make it an actionable item, Father God. Cause it, Lord God, to be a testimony, Lord, to those that are around us. Lord, cause it to be the report that we bring back to people, Father. Hallelujah. About, Lord, yeah, he did it. I've been sitting on this thing for a minute, but I got up and I started moving it. God, help me to cause it to be successful. Lord God, whatever you want to do in our lives, come on, we're ready. Lord, we're ready, God. We're ready, God. Hallelujah. Lord, no more fear because you didn't even create us to fear, God. You didn't create us to worry, God. You didn't create us to have low self-esteem, God. You didn't create us to be sick, Lord God, and lethargic, God, and tired, God, and all these other things we keep talking about ourselves, God. Lord, you created us, Lord, to be amazing, to be great, God, to leap, Lord God, over mountains, Father God, to fly and soar to the highest of the highest, God. And Lord, today, Father, I say for myself, God, yes. It's a yes for me. I'm leaping, God. It's a yes for me, God. I'm ready, God. You done delivered me from way too much, God, to sit around and do nothing. So, Lord God, I just pray, Father, that you ignite us all. Ignite us all, God, to go forth and do what you have called us to do, Father. Not for our sake, Lord, like Pastor Saul said, not for us, God. Hallelujah. But for somebody else that's around us, God, that needs to see that thing, Father God, and give that $60, Lord God, or Lord God, to start that business, like, or write a book and make a movie, Father God, like the Wallaces, Father, whatever needs to be done, Lord God. We're ready. We say yes, Lord. Not our will, but thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We love you, Jesus. Be safe. Glory be to God. Amen. Communion is right after. Hallelujah.